There's always that one player that you're shocked to score a hat-trick for your club. Let's take a look at the most surprising player to have scored a league hat-trick, Premier League or Championship, and just have a look. Arsenal, Jermaine Pennant versus Southampton, 2003. When Jermaine Pennant first burst onto the scene for Arsenal, everyone thought he was going to be the second coming of Christ. Yet, within a few years, he'd be leaving spare Porsches parked across Europe and dragging his poor girlfriend under the set of Jeremy Kyle for a cheap night out. Thrown onto the pitch against Southampton as a sprightly teenager with a stomach full of vodka and lime, Britain's most expensive teenager scored 3 on his full debut in a 6-1 win against Southampton in May 2003. Within 3 years, he was moping around the pitch with a jail tag stuck to his ankle. What a guy. Bournemouth, Josh King versus West Ham, 2017. Was I the only one who didn't fall for Josh King's goal scoring antics a few seasons back? He scored 16 during the 16-17 season for Bournemouth, including all 3 in a 3-2 win over West Ham towards the end of the season. Considering this was a striker who had looked about as threatening in front of goal as a dead hamster throughout his career, I was not falling for this. It's 18 months later and he's since scored 14 goals. I was proven right. Brighton, Tom Rahimed versus Fulham, 2016. Okay, so this was a championship game as well, and to be honest, Tom Rahimed scored a lot of goals in the championship, but to me, he never seemed like a great player, so I don't know. To be honest, there hasn't been a lot of players who scored hat-tricks for Brighton for some reason. I don't know why. Burnley, Andre Gray versus Sunderland, 2016. Again, like King, I was never blown away by Andre Gray, a man who's probably seen as the next Hitler at LGBT movements. He's never hit double digits in a single season in the Premier League. For an £18 million striker, that's not great. He did get a hat-trick in a 4-1 win for Burnley over Sunderland in December 2016, though. That's sort of when everyone realised that David Moyes didn't know what the hell he was doing. Cardiff City, Peter Whittingham versus Sheffield United, 2009. Now, don't get me wrong, Peter Whittingham has been a great servant down at Cardiff City, but he's not exactly a prolific goal scorer. Then again, he did score 20 during this campaign, so I probably shouldn't be too shocked. It was October 2009 and he scored 3 in a 4-3 win at Sheffield United, equaling his entire total from the previous season. The drug testers were probably knocking at his door after every game. Chelsea, Samuel Eto'o versus Man United, 2014. Okay, Samuel Eto'o has probably scored about 10 hat-tricks in his entire career. What's so special about this? Well, probably due to the fact that he's just been dragged back from the wilderness of Russia, was creaking around the pitch like a 53-year-old with arthritis in both knees, and yet was still good enough to fire 3 past the side coached by David Moyes. There are only 4 survivors from the entire Manchester United squad from that day, and one of them is Phil Jones. Crystal Palace, Yannick Bolasie versus Sunderland, 2015. This was mental. Not only was this Yannick Bolasie's first Premier League hat-trick, he was scoring this in 11 minutes, as Crystal Palace turned up with Sunderland, battered them 4-1, and waved off the fans. Everton, Stephen Naismith versus Chelsea, 2015. There were a few options to choose from. For Christ's sake, Aruna Kone and a fat Rooney have scored hat-tricks for this club. But no, let's go for Stephen Naismith, who scored a treble against Chelsea. The man didn't even start the game. With Mourinho having spent the summer pining after Everton's star centre-half, he was probably the baldy Scotsman they should have been more worried about. After he crawled onto the pitch after 9 minutes, he scored 3 goals, despite possessing the ball control of a dying squirrel, though worse than Chelsea's embarrassing start of the season. Yeah, don't worry lads, it was about to get a lot worse. Fulham, Pavel Pogrebnyak versus Wolves, 2012. When someone called Pavel Pogrebnyak is scoring a hat-trick against you, that's when you know it's probably time to pack it in and wave the Premier League goodbye. Poor old Wolves. I mean, back then there was no Portuguese revolution, it was just Stephen Ward at left back and Terry Connor in the dugout. Oh boys. To be fair, Pogrebnyak was an okay player, but 3 goals and a 5-0 defeat? Christ, Wolves were bad that season. Huddersfield Town, James Vaughan versus Bournemouth, 2013. So this was in the Championship, with James Vaughan netting a 21-minute hat-trick as his newly promoted Huddersfield ran off 5-1 winners over Bournemouth. Who knew within 5 years this would be a Premier League fixture? And that Vaughan, the Premier League's youngest ever goal scorer, would have been struggling to keep his head above League One. Leicester City, Riyad Mahrez versus Swansea City. Now don't get me wrong, Riyad Mahrez is a special player. I mean, he might have just handed Liverpool the title this season with that botched Anfield penalty, but I never really pegged him as the hat-trick type. In December 2015, Mahrez scored all 3 at Swansea City to propel Leicester to the top of the Premier League. It's nearly 4 years later and it still sounds weird. Christ above, when the left winger is ending up with 3 goals all for himself, Gary Monk should probably have had Kyle Naughton brought out back and fed to the sheep. Liverpool, Maxi Rodriguez versus Fulham, 2011. This was only strange because this was Maxi Rodriguez's second hat-trick in a month. What was going on? Under Roy Hodgson, this fella looked fit for the nursing home. Yeah, let's be honest, possible euthanasia, such was his inability to cross the goddamn ball. Now under Kenny Dalglish, he was going left, right and centre. 3 in a 5-0 win against Birmingham, and now another treble in a 5-2 victory at Craven Cottage. Slow down, Maxi, before you break a hip. Man City, Edin Dzeko vs Tottenham, 2011. This was supposed to be the iron test for Man City if they were serious about finally winning a league title. Travelling to White Hart Lane in August 2011 to face a side that had stalled their Champions League hopes by a year. Not 5-1. 5-1 absolutely swept aside with Edin Dzeko, a man who had been roundly criticised by the likes of Richard Keys, then again it is Richard Keys, scoring 4. Statement of intent. Man United, Shinji Kagawa vs Norwich, 2013. Shinji Kagawa was a flop at Manchester United, but at least he'd always have this one moment when he somehow snuck onto the pitch against Norwich in May 2013 and bagged himself 3 in a 4-0 win, before he was quickly packaged up in a duffel bag, shipped back to Germany and was never seen again. Newcastle, Leon Best vs West Ham, 2011. Imagine setting your star striker and only source of goals goals with 15 seconds of the transfer window left and replacing him with a pudgy 35-year-old who hadn't scored a Premier League goal in 6 years. Only Mike Ashley. Thankfully, it wasn't so bad. At the start of January, Newcastle had swept West Ham aside 5-0 with Leon Bess scoring a hat-trick. I think he was as surprised as anyone, considering he'd been at the club for a year, with half of that being in the goddamn championship, and hadn't so much as sniffed in the direction of a goal. If I were the West Ham defenders, I'd have contemplated drowning myself in a bath 20 minutes after the game. Southampton, Marek Saganowski versus Wolves, 2007. Wolves 0, Southampton 6. March 2007. A weird scoreline for sure. Another game Leon Bess played in, actually. Poland international Marek Saganowski scored a treble in this game. Looked great, tricked the club into signing on a permanent basis, and then spent the next 3 years getting fat and playing with all the gumption of a wet paper bag. Tottenham, Jermaine Defoe. Considering Jermaine Defoe had been left out of the last World Cup due to some 17-year-old kid, and he obviously missed Euro 2008 thanks to Steve McLaren's inadequacies, there was no way he was going to miss the 2010 tournament. He started this season absolutely on fire for Tottenham. I mean, this wasn't even his first hat-trick. He'd already scored a treble against Hull City, so it wasn't really too surprising that he tore Wigan to shreds. But did anyone see him scoring 5 in one game? No, sorry, did anyone see him scoring 5 in one half? It was absolutely mental. 9-1, Defoe scoring 5. It was just ridiculous. Like, some of those Wigan defenders had children. I mean, come on. I mean, I know Titus Bramble's family was probably used to humiliation on a weekly basis, but still, let's not forget, it had only been less than 2 years that Defoe had been kicked out of Spurs because apparently he wasn't good enough. And here he was, scoring 5 goals for them in one game. Incredible. Watford, Odion Ighalo versus Blackpool, 2015. It didn't surprise me that Odion Ighalo scored a hat-trick in this game. He would score 20 that season. It was the championship, but the scoreline, 7-2. In January 2015, 7-2. This was supposed to be a club who were in the Premier League a few years earlier, and they were 2-0 up at halftime. How the hell did they manage to lose by 5 goddamn goals? West Ham, Marlon Harewood versus Aston Villa, 2005. The fact that Marlon Harewood appears anywhere in this list is incredible enough. The fact that this hat-trick occurred in the Premier League just makes a mockery of the whole thing. September 2005, 4-0 at home against Aston Villa with Harewood, Marlon Harewood, scoring 3. Villa, hang your heads in shame. And also hang them again for being tricked into actually signing this man later on. Wolves, Carl Court versus QPR, 2005. Look, I'm not going to sit here and lie to you and pretend that I ever watched this game or even knew this took place. Wolves beating QPR 3-1 at home on a damp Tuesday night in the Championship some 14 years ago. No, I'm sure even the people that attended this game have forgotten all about it. But the fact that Carl Court, a man who will be more remembered simply for the fact that he wasn't shown on the Obi, managed to score a hat-trick that day, I think it's painfully obvious why QPR didn't go up that year or for 6 years thereafter.